All right. When you look inside yourselves, huh? Do you see a knight? Viking? Samurai, perhaps, huh? When your enemies are arriving at the gate, and the sword is coming at your head, would you turn and run? Would you stand and fight? For honor offers you the opportunity to experience the adrenaline and the danger of a melee combat in a visceral battlefield through a new type of gameplay that we call the art of battle. You will feel the weight of the weapon in your hand, the crash as you block the attack, and the impact when you strike the winning blow.
Episode 169 of the Gamers in Beta podcast. This is your host, Mike Mahoney, a.k.a. Captain Mike M. And I've discovered that PS2 gaming is alive and well on the Xbox One. Details to follow.
Hi, and I am effeminate PS4 gamer Corey Atwood.
And I've been experiencing martyrdom through a Capcom ROM hack. And my name is Joe State.
And this is Maniac17, a.k.a. Jay. And I've got some pre-release apples with no headphone jacks. I picked them out of the tree.
What's going on, fellas? It is the middle of September. I'm sweating my balls off because the humidity is back in town. But last week, Corey and myself met up at Boston Fig, and we saw some games. What's going on, Corey?
Yeah, that was a good time, man. I always look forward to the Festival of Indie Games, and it was way bigger this year than it's been every year. It has exponentially gotten bigger and girthier every year.
It was an interesting year because in years past, I don't felt that it was like the show floor itself was run that well. Sometimes you showed up and people were just setting up and it was later in the day. This year it seemed way more organized. They even had swag and everything like that. But what was weird and lacking is they didn't send any press things out to us to like make appointments. So for me, it was a little weird just walking around aimlessly looking at games. A few did catch my eye, but you certainly seem to be more organized than myself. You had a list of games that you wanted to check out. Since you haven't been on in a few weeks, why don't we hear from you and tell us some of the games that you did play and that stood out for you?
Yeah, truth be told, you and I did get press emails. I think we both got them like literally the morning of the Boston Festival of Indie Games. Yeah, it was like I think those were tabletop games. The emails I got.
I'm not sure what happened. I know when I talked to Emma from Dreamsail, who the devs that work on Blade Ballet, they said they didn't get a press list.
Yeah, I assume they didn't because they're usually pretty aggressive with their press list, but I was kind of glad that they didn't. I felt like it was more free. Like, I didn't feel like I would need to, like, cut out on somebody else's demo or agree to a demo and then get 2 seconds into it and realize, like, I really don't like this game, but then feel obligated to play it, like, for the next 20 minutes.
Do you want to just quickly go back to last year and talk about that Superman demo and what happened?
Oh, you brought that up.
I think that's always a funny story.
As soon as you and I got there, you brought that up. Can you remember the name of the game? It was like Megaton, I think it was called.
Something like that, yeah.
Megaton Rainfall, something like that.
That sounds about right.
Something vaguely related to Fallout, which is right off the bat a bad idea because you're like, what? Is this a Fallout thing? So it's unclear. But this guy, he had this idea for a game. This was long before No Man's Sky, too. Everybody just seen the video for No Man's Sky. But it was a first-person superhero game where you essentially had, like, Superman powers. And you could land on the surface of the Earth or fly all the way up into space and fly like around the planet and land back down on Earth, which seems like a really cool idea, but it was such a rough and badly designed game that when anybody took the demo, it was almost impossible to play right. And the guy, when I took the demo, the guy sat next to me and practically yelled at me the entire time because I wasn't playing the game right. And then I think he complained about me to Mike when Mike took his demo.
Jay and I had the appointment right afterwards, and he was like, this last guy that was here, he was terrible. Oh my God, I'm so frustrated by him. What an annoying person. You know, something along those lines. You know?
What a dick.
I knew you had the appointment before us.
Yeah,
so I found that hilarious. But it was like a Superman game, and you couldn't destroy any of the buildings or kill anybody. You only could kill like the robots, but it was just impossible. And the guy was like, yeah, this is coming out in like just a few months on Xbox One and PS4. Never saw the light of day.
Never, ever.
Oh, it was horrible.
It vanished after. It was weird. Like the alien ships looked like these long, like, I don't know, rods. not to make fun of the design of the ship, but like you could only destroy the ship by turning a certain way and shooting at like the back end of it, which means you were also shooting at the building that if you destroyed, you would fail. So it was insanely hard to do, like really frustrating. And he was getting mad at me for shooting the side of the alien. I'm like, I'm shooting an alien with my superpower. I don't understand why I'm not hurting it. But yeah, apparently he didn't even like me as a person after that demo. He was just sick of me, hated my whole family, hated the way I drove, hated my breath. I don't know. Guy was a dick.
So what did you see this week, this year, that you liked?
I saw a few. You want to start out with the one that you and I agreed was probably one of the best in show there?
Hands down, my favorite. I mean, you know, The Flame and the Flood was there, and that's probably what we would all agree the best game there because it's already out, very well polished.
Been out for like a year or so. It was there for like they were giving a talk on like creating environments or something like that.
Right.
So that's why they were there. But yeah, that game's been out and it's fantastic. I recommend going to pick it up on Xbox One.
So that certainly was the best game there. But again, it's already out. So the game that hasn't been released that I enjoyed the most was Ape Out. And Devolver's putting this out. And it's right in Devolver's wheelhouse with I don't know how you'd say, tongue-in-cheek humor, you know, very timely what's going on in the world, especially with apes, and, you know.
Although he started development like 2 years before this whole Harambe thing, and everybody was making Harambe references every time they'd play it, and he would just kind of shrug it off. He's like, yeah, I'm not going to reference it because I don't want to date my game, but at the same time, I'm not going to shy away. I'm not going to change my game because this whole, you know, stupid meme is haunting the internet right now.
So basically, it was like Hotline Miami as an ape, and you know there was just you were just busting out of your enclosure, so to speak, and you had all these various types of guys. Some of them were just brawlers. Some of them had like, we'll just say like sticks that could, what do they call those, electrocutable sticks or chargers that would
cattle prods.
Yes, exactly. Thank you.
Yeah, and some guys had shotguns. Some guys had rifles. They were like, melee guys, and you just had to get from point A to point B. You had to get to the left side of the map to the right side of the map. It was like some sort of testing facility that you had to escape.
Right.
And it was all top down, just like a Hotline Miami, which is also a Devolver Digital, so it totally makes sense for that publisher. And you're an ape, so your only means of like offense is you can just like shove the guys or grab them and hold them like meat shields and eventually just chuck them at the other guys. And when they hit the wall, it was like this cartoonish level of violence. They would just splatter and their bodies would stay there. So a whole level would just be like splattered bodies of guards. It was so satisfying. I don't know why it was so much fun.
When you crushed them up against the wall, it was. And what was satisfying to me is that the soundtrack was just one big drum solo. But when you smashed the guy, one of the guards into the wall, it gave you like a cymbal hit. You know, it was really cleverly done.
Yeah, and the screen would like shake a little bit. So it was like this real like, you could feel like the gravity of the like thud of the bodies hitting the wall and like people reacting to it because it's very minimal art style.
Yes.
But the blood, when people would see it, people would just walk by and be like, oh, shit, and stop and watch.
And some of the guards had like explosives on their back. And if you got near them or you just punched them, they would explode right away. But if you used the meat shield technique, they would not explode. So you'd want to carry the guy around that had the explosives on his back. And then if you could herd a bunch of the other guys into like a corner, then you want to throw that guy at them and he would kill them all. And that was pretty awesome too.
It seems like a really bad technique for herding an animal back into its enclosure, suicide bomb. I mean, I would go with a dart gun personally, but I mean, to each their own, I guess.
Right. But there was, you know, I don't know how much more polish you can put into a game like that. It certainly felt like to me that it was close to being done. I imagine he has to build out some more levels. That would be the thing that probably could delay the game. But just the art style was, like you said, very simple. But go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think a lot of what they have to do is legal stuff as far as the music goes, because he said he literally just took something off YouTube. Like, he just took it to throw it in. Yeah, he was like, yeah, I'm not going to put new music in because everybody likes it, so I think I just have to pay the guy. So he has to work out all the
galleries. Thought I heard that conversation. He was talking to the guy, though, right? There was some communication.
Yeah, he'd been in talks with him. The guy was like, yeah, you can use it at the show. I don't care. But if it ends up in the final game, you'll have to like work out all that contract.
Yeah. So we're going to try to get the guy from Ape Out and Forrest from the dev who worked on Flame and the Flood on the show. So look for those in upcoming episodes. Anything else that you had to say about Ape Out, or you want to move on?
I want to talk about Pixel Ball really quick. You and I played Pixel Ball for a while. That was like, it's like Dive Kick meets Super Dodgeball. It was like a one-on-one dodgeball game, like 2D, just like Dive Kick. And you can play as different characters, and you can mix and match which character you have with which ball you can throw. And each ball has different, like, attributes. So each match could be, like, 1 second or, like, up to a full minute, and they would get really, really intense. And one hit, you know, you take out your opponent. Five hits wins the entire game, and that was a lot of fun. I could have stayed and played that for a while, but a lot of people were you know, crowding it, so we had to let people play.
That was a very popular game on the floor, but it's one of those party games. I'm not sure if there was any online component to that. It seemed like it was local multiplayer.
He actually said he had the online working before the local, but then he had to get the local working for the Festival of Indie Games, so he took that offline right now. But when it ships, it'll be both offline and online. He's going to add 2v2, and I believe it's coming to consoles too. If there's enough interest, he said, it's going to come from consoles. But it's already greenlit on Steam, and I believe you can play it on his website right now, actually, the current build.
mlstudios.net.
Mm-hmm.
Any other games that you saw?
The only other one I definitely want to mention is Perception, which that was the blind one. The studio, they just formed, I think it's the Deep End Games,
yes,
I think is the name of the studio. It's for veterans from the Bioshock series, Dead Space, and Rock Band. And I think the art direction is led by the guy who designed the Little Sisters in Bioshock. It's super creepy. It's kind of like a walking sim. It's like Gone Home meets Outlast. And you play as like a blind protagonist who has to tap her cane, of course, to echolocate her way around this hotel. And you're being stalked by the presence. And you really don't have any means of offense. You have to like run and hide. And it was really, really intense. So I can imagine playing that at home would be more intense than playing it right on the show floor like we had to.
So we've had Bill on before talking about the game. And Jay is a backer of Perception as well. I'm not sure if that's the same build from PAX or not. It looked like it to me. It was a lengthy demo, wasn't it?
Yeah, I didn't even get to finish it. I got quite a ways into it, and I just felt like I'd been hogging it for a while, and there were like four or five people around me at the time, and I heard someone ask, can I play it? And I was like, yeah, you can take mine, because that room was sweltering hot.
Yeah.
Like, I was like dripping sweat, so I was like, I got to go outside for a little while. So, yeah, I just handed it off. I think I probably did about 80% of it, but, yeah, that was the longest demo I took that day.
I think that won the Best in Show.
Yeah, I think it did. I saw him tweet that.
Something like that, yeah. So, very good game. I thought they had a good turnout this year. You know, a lot of people walking around, a lot of, you know, games to check out. There wasn't too many VR games. There was, the Kung Fu game?
Yeah,
and
there
I
was...
I saw a whole bunch of sweaty people trying that on, and I just stayed clear of that. And then there was one game that you tried to get on right away as soon as the sort of floor opened up. What was that one?
That was Intern Astronaut. It was a Gear VR game. It was like the Samsung Gear VR, so it's just literally like a cell phone in a headset. And I've yet to be able to use one of those types of VRs and not get it, you know, so it's not a little bit blurry. It's always slightly blurry for me, so that was kind of a turnoff. But it's a very simple game. You just sit in a chair, and your character is sitting in a chair, so there's no problem with nausea. and you get a flash like prompt on the screen, you know, you have to flip this switch, turn this knob, or else, you know, your spaceship is going to blow up. So you just have to follow instructions very quickly. It was a short, cute little game. I think it's a good game for people who want to try out VR and never have before. And it's probably a good mobile VR game. I would say it's good for that. As far as like a, you know, PS VR or Vive or something goes, it's a little bit lacking. It's a little bit small, but it works for a PS or a mobile VR game, I think.
You didn't try Kung Fu Shadow Fist, did you?
No, I saw some really enthusiastic demos right. of it, but no, I didn't. They actually sent me an email after the show,
yep,
like as I was leaving the show.
Yep. So interesting, Jay, you were missed this year. Corey, what would you rate on a scale of 1 to 10 your fine dining from Anna's Taqueria?
I was smart this year, and I did not put myself into a big food coma afterwards. So I would, but we were missing Jay. Jay was not there to get the super super burrito.
I wanted that super super burrito. That looked delicious.
There's so many supers.
$13.50 for that.
I've been all over it.
It was annoying. It was like the size of a small child.
Snack.
I would have to put it down a 6.5 because we didn't have Jay there to eat the super super.
Look at that.
Man. I promise. I'll make sure nobody schedules a wedding for next year.
I won an eating contest on a Cinco de Mayo once by eating a 5-pound burrito in under half an hour.
Wow. Holy shit.
I bow to you, sir.
That sounds like a long time, but then when you say 5 pounds, it probably gets daunting about like 2.5 pounds in, and you're like, shit, I got another half to go.
I was the only one that could do it.
Damn, dude. I don't know if I could do that. I can eat.
And then someone was like, yeah, you did it. I'll buy you a beer. And I was like, duh.
Where's it going to fit?
Now, what was in the burrito? Was it just a regular bean and cheese burrito, or was there meat in there?
Oh, no. It was like pico de gallo, lettuce, rice, meat, and cheese.
Like all types of meat, or just like one, like pork?
I think it was only one.
How much did the new toilet cost after you destroyed yours?
I just went home and went to sleep. Like, I couldn't even exist after that.
You got the food coma, the definition of food coma.
Right? Yeah, I died.
I picture that burrito coming out of your ass like the alien coming out of the stomach. Just,
an angry fist.
Yeah.
Angry fist of cheese. I wonder how much cheese is in a 5-pound burrito.
Too much.
Well, let's move on to Bioshock Remasters, the Bioshock Collection. It is not doing well. Shock and surprise. It seems like anytime these things get released these days, they don't live up to the hype. They don't live up to the standards that we want. And I haven't heard too much about the console versions. I know Gamer Goalie, Dave from GameHounds, his wife is at least playing it on the Xbox One. And he says it looks great and it runs great. And he hasn't mentioned anything to me otherwise.
And he said he did mention that he's playing on a 4K TV and it looks good up-resed, he said.
Yes.
To quote him.
Yes, exactly. And so some people on the PC, though, seem to be very displeased. Quotes are, "This is as lazy as PC porting gets, folks. The game looks like Bioshock in pretty much most regards. Only a better lighting and a very slightly sharper texture pack was implemented." Other people saying it has stutters, and apparently people have crashes. I've only played 30 minutes, but those were fine. So it's not doing well. But we are getting these for free, Jay. Did you play them at all?
I have not. I did download them. I set them to download last night. I have them downloaded. I just haven't had a chance to play them. And it's not just an update of the old game. It's actually you'll see in your Steam library, if you look below it, you'll see remastered. Yep. So, but I haven't even started it yet. So, but who did the port on this? Do we know?
I don't know, but Ken from Irrational Games did an interview this weekend that was in Rolling Stone, of all places. With this, Rolling Stone must have rerun the story of the interview. This game, I've never heard of this gaming site before. It's called Glixel. Have you guys heard of that before?
No.
Never.
Glixel. Well, he did this exclusive interview with them, and the people asked him about the collection, and he says that he wasn't even asked about it. Nothing was run by him. And one interesting thing I got from that interview is that he originally told 2K that he was leaving. And maybe this is common knowledge and I'm just hearing about this for the first time. But he told 2K that he was leaving and they offered him some sort of package to stay on. But he said he was done with Bioshock, didn't want to do it again, and that he was leaving. He agreed to this new deal to stay on and so he could head up his own thing. And it's sort of the tone of it sort of sounded like, well, I did this because I thought they would keep Irrational and Irrational would make the next Bioshock game, but without me. And I guess come to find out, they didn't want that. They closed Irrational. So found that interesting in the article.
So he's saying he didn't want to close Irrational? I thought it was his choice to shut down Irrational.
That's what I understood as well. But when you read this interview on Glixel, he said, nope, that he wanted to leave. He was done with the Bioshock franchise. He wanted to leave to do his own game. 2K intervened, gave him some sort of, you know, sweetheart deal or something. Stay on. You don't have to do anything with Bioshock. And then it was his assumption that Irrational would stay on to do the next game. And that's when they closed him down.
I mean, it was clear that he didn't want to make any more Bioshock games. I'm surprised he still wanted to make video games at all.
Like, well, that's what he says. That's what he says in the interview.
What, that he was done with the game industry?
No, he says he's only doing this because he wants to make money. He says, you know, if I didn't need to make money, I would just make games and never release them.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like that's kind of the impression I got from playing Infinite. I feel like that was one of the big themes of the game is, you know, spoilers at the end, you know, there's an infinite number of universes and all games are essentially the same. And, you know, no matter what you do, you really don't have a choice and choice is an illusion. It seems like from the impression I got, he was just done with video games permanently.
So Glixel is Rolling Stone. It's their video game website.
When he left Irrational, he left because he also said that he still wanted to make games, but he doesn't want to make them on a scale of infinity because they had so many issues with that. I mean, think Rod Ferguson came in, and if it weren't for him, they probably wouldn't have gotten it finished. He kind of consolidated and said, look, this is, you know, kind of did produced on it and said, this is what we need to get it done. And they put it together, and luckily it came out the way it did. But I think it just got too big for him. I think he said he wanted to go and do indie games. He just wants to do 2-3 person projects.
Yeah, in this article he mentions The Division, and he says, I'm walking around in The Division and looking at all these trash bags and street signs and saying, all right, a team of 15 just didn't create all these trash bags and street signs. There has to be hundreds of people in various parts of the world creating everything you're seeing in this game. And he says what he gets the most out of making games is the collaboration. That's what he describes it as, a warm feeling. Insert your joke here. But, you know, he says that's what he's all about, is those, you know, sort of one-on-one interactions or team interactions. And when you're making a game the size of what people expect these days, you don't get those types of relationships anymore. It's just like, all right, here's a team in Bangladesh. Make us 15,000 million trillion trash bags that we can put in this game.
It's always sad when a studio closes. Like, Irrational Games was a great studio. They made some great games. And it's always sad when a studio closes, but I would love to play some indie games that were, led up by Levine. And Irrational Games closing freed up a ton of – I mean, they're in the Boston area. So freed up a ton of local devs who were – a lot of them got together on their own, Deep End Studios, The Molasses Flood. And they were like, hey, let's make a game together. So a lot of great things are actually coming out of it. You know, like a great studio dies and some great things – grow out of their corpse, I guess. So it seems like it has a happy ending, but not for people who wanted a Bioshock remaster, I guess.
Yeah, that was Blind Squirrel Games that did that. Blind Squirrel Entertainment.
So here's the quote exactly about him leaving Irrational, just to sort of circle back to that to make sure I have it right. He says, initially I told them I was leaving the company. I said I wanted to do a much smaller thing. It's very experimental. They asked me to stay. I figured they would keep Irrational for the next Bioshock. That's not what happened.
Oh, I never heard that before.
So again, it was always out in the press, like he closed Irrational because he wanted to move on and do something. In this article, it doesn't really, you don't really get that feeling.
Yeah, I mean, I do remember him coming out and saying he wanted to do smaller projects. I do remember that, but I was still under the impression that it was because he was done with the Bioshock series, and therefore, you know, there wasn't any income to support a studio of that size.
This is really a good article that everybody should read who's, you know, vaguely interested in how games are made, and specifically around Bioshock and Irrational. One other thing I'll leave you with before we move on is Bioshock was about to be released, and they had some playtesters come in on a Friday, and no one knew what the game was. It tested horribly. The playtester tapped Ken on the back and said, "This game is going to fucking tank." And so he said they met the next day on a Saturday, all depressed and down and out, and they had to figure out what to do with the game. And then you should go on and read the article because he talks about what they did. But very interesting to see 8 people said the game sucked and it's not going to do well, and it sold a shit ton, right?
Yeah.
And I was going to say, I mean, along these lines, you know, like I said, it's Blind Squirrel that did it. They also did Disney Infinity. And a lot of this is they do contract work. And they did Evolve. They worked on Evolve. We all know how that worked. Sunset Overdrive, Bioshock Infinite, XCOM Enemy Unknown, and Borderlands 2. Mostly bug fixing and stuff like that.
So did Blind Squirrel just do the PC, or they did the PC and consoles?
I believe they did both.
And I haven't seen any articles about the consoles yet. I want to play through these again, and I think I'm going to pick it up on the Xbox One. Just because I'm in the mood to play these on the couch, and if I already have the PC ones free, you know, I don't know. We'll see what happens. Maybe it's something I asked Santa for. Maybe there'll be a price decrease by then, a sale. But let's move on to the community question of the week. The question was, what is your preferred media format for watching movies at home? Now, last week, we talked about the PS4 Pro and them not including a UHD Blu-ray drive. And this sort of spurred the question of the week this week. So let's see what the community has to say. First, we have Denny, a beer guy, a.k.a. Loose Screw of Tap the Craft. He says, unlike the majority of the host, I still prefer Blu-ray for high def. Crappy DSL like Jay. But not going 4K Blu-ray for a while. Again, I am a cheap bastard. And I currently don't have a 4K drive and have a first-gen 4K TV without HDR. So I'm not in a hurry. And I only have 4K TV because my old projection TV died. And I went with the best at that time. Thank you, Denny. Let's see, Brian Young back from P-Town, juggler of geese on the Twitters. He says, Blu-ray DVD most of the time, but for movies like Star Wars, I'm buying digital into the end-all be-all special collection. So it sounds like Brian's been burnt in the past by buying some of these DVDs or Blu-rays, and then they come out with another version. Have you guys done that at all with Star Wars?
Oh, yeah. I think my first collection was VHS. I had the original trilogy on VHS, and every time a new one comes out, they would add, like, definitive edition, even though I knew there were going to be more.
Director's cut from the bathroom.
Yeah, I have the first 6 on Blu-ray as, like, a collection. But, yeah, I think Star Wars is probably the only thing that I'm actually still buying physical for. So I agree with you, Juggler of Geese.
And lastly here, Chase Langdon at Awaken Heathen. I love physical, and I still buy it for keeping. But watch more digital. Same with music. Hashtag GIB community.
Yeah. All right, so our next one is Sam at Valagis. I'm totally sorry that I screwed that up. At Valagis on the Twitter. Streaming from Netflix, Amazon, at Glovebox's Furlough Theater, etc., etc. Naughty boy.
What up, Glovebox?
Soup!
And the next one is Alex, Mr. Skyzon of the 40cast. It's pretty much 90% streaming. I do buy Blu-ray discs of movies / cartoons when they are on sale. I should do that more often, too. There's not many physical I buy anymore, but I think I would probably buy... I think I'd probably buy physical Simpsons first, you know, 7 or 8 seasons of that. You can't, that's still not streaming anywhere, I think, at least not legally. Yeah. So, And the last one is Damien Ourso at Afterthought 051 of Dad's Getting Grounded. He says, I buy the Blu-ray combo pack still. I make sure it has digital, but with digital being the same price as the disc, I'm going to buy the pack to get more bang for my buck. Digital needs to get cheaper or have better sales. And I am not going to disagree with him about that.
Shut up and take my money.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you, Jay.
Oh. Double A Ron at Indio Techno. I'll stream or Redbox if we really want to watch it on the cheap. But Google and Xbox have lots of rental deals lately. How much is it, Mr. Matt?
Oh, sorry. Go ahead. How much is it to rent from the Xbone dashboard? I have yet to do that.
Generally that, $3 to $6, something like that.
For newer releases?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
In HD, because it's different for standard def.
I think Redbox is
$2 or $3 now.
Yeah, two. That's what I thought.
For Blu-ray, I think it's more. So I'm not sure. I don't use Redbox. So. And to continue on, Devious Mr. Matt. Of the 40 cast, well, yeah, X-Hamster for sure for my late-night cravings. Other than that, Amazon is usually my go-to, then Netflix or Hulu.
I didn't want to interrupt you with it. I didn't know if you
had to. Oh, no, you had to. That was perfect.
I'm glad you also know what X-Hamster is.
Yeah. Shownuff 71 of Gamer Husbands, and if you don't know what X-Hamster is, look it up.
But not
Google
at work.
It. Not at work.
Not
at work. Not to get the ball rolling.
Yes. So Shownuff 71 of Gamer Husbands. I don't watch a lot of movies, but for the most part, I'll use On Demand or Redbox a physical.
Redbox a physical sounds like some other sort of...
Yeah.
Just saying.
That sounds like a keyword search on X-Hamster.
Physical. Gotta use your fingers for that one.
Ooh.
Ben at Shaw_Near says streaming via TVs, consoles, and tablets. I buy Blu-rays, so I get the discs for the same price, but rarely use them. Whatever, Ben, you wimp. Los at The Elusive Man of the Future Monkeys podcast says, I prefer Blu-rays, but laziness prevails once again. All the movies we've watched recently have been streamed or digitally rented. The DVD case is behind all the kid toys. Don't judge me. We also Redboxed recently for the first time in forever. But anyway, who needs movies with The Rise of Iron out this week? Right, Joe State? Rise of Iron's that new Iron Man porn, right? You probably see that on X-Hamster.
I'm still chuckling at Redbox recently for the first time. Again, my mind is in the gutter.
Getting a lot of use out of this Beavis and Butthead.
Oh, man.
So that was some good replies there. Thanks to everybody for sending in their submissions. Let's quickly go around and see what everybody's preferred format is. Jay, what about yourself?
I would prefer digital, but again, if I'm going to do 4K, I'm going to have to do Blu-ray 4Ks, or Ultra Blu-ray, which I do not own any of yet. I was going to get, what was the, Deadpool, but, I didn't. And then I went and got the 4K and got the TV afterwards. So I was like, shit, should have done it. But, otherwise, pretty much digital, stream everything, you know, watch it. So
now with your internet, is it still 1080p?
I can get 1080, yeah, as long as nobody's on Facebook or uploading pictures.
Or Jesus. Squirrels on the wire.
Jesus.
Well, the squirrels on the wire help. Get better reception.
All right. Corey, what about yourself?
As I've mentioned before, I am a digital snob. If it's physical and it's made after like 1996, you can just feed it to the poor. I don't need it. So pretty much everything I watch is either Amazon or Netflix streaming or Pornhub or XNXX while we're at it. So
now, does your vehicle have a DVD player in it?
My vehicle? No. I've experimented with that in the past. That never works out very well. And those mobile DVD players kind of suck anyway. So, no.
His porn is always skipping.
We have one built into our Honda, and it's got a decent screen. Decent, and my kids absolutely love it.
Yeah, is the screen in the headrest of the seats?
No, it comes down
so the kids can watch in the back. That comes from the ceiling.
Yep.
And that's for the kids to watch in the back, right? You can't see it from the front seats.
Right. I don't think that's legal, is it?
Shh.
there are certain mirrors you can buy. You could fix that situation.
Well, I know they have it. They have it in like trucks and stuff like that. A friend of mine has a Ram truck, and he was looking for. I guess there's a dongle you can buy for it that will prevent it because it prevents itself from playing DVDs when the truck is in motion because the screen's in the dash. And I guess there's a dongle you can get that will prevent it from doing that so that you can watch them.
You're really a super great asshole. I mean, I guess if there's someone in the passenger seat, okay. But otherwise, you're really, if you're just driving around in your truck and you're the only one in there and you're watching a movie while you're driving, you're a grade A asshole. Grade A. You're like right up there with the top of the top assholes.
Hey, man, some of those stretches of highway in Maine, they're pretty long and lonely. There's nothing going on. You got to.
They're 75 now. You can do 75.
Should pop it on. Thin out the population a bit. Hit. Hope you hit a tree.
No, it'd be more like a moose.
Joe, what about yourself?
All digital, all the time.
Yeah. That's what I'm talking about.
You know, I don't watch a lot of movies. My wife and I, if we watch something, you know, it's pretty much TV shows. And if we do watch movies, it's mostly Redbox. We buy a fair amount of physical stuff for the kids, just like I talked about, for long drives in the car. They can watch stuff. I just bought Civil War the other day. My oldest is really big into, you know, comics and stuff like that. So season 2 of Flash is out, but I don't find a way that you can watch that anywhere for free. So you could get it from, like, Amazon Prime for, like, $2 an episode.
Yeah, you can rent it on Xbox, too.
I think the first season is free either on Amazon or Netflix, but I think
he's already seen that. Yeah, so yeah. Season 3 is starting soon, I guess. I'm just going on what he's telling me, and so he wanted season 2. And if you go on Amazon, I want to say to buy a physical it was like $35. So we just went to eBay today and got it for like $13.50.
Yeah,
six disc, brand new, still sealed.
Supporting my people.
Yep.
So that's an ABC show, right? That's on ABC.
No, CW.
The CW? Because I thought it was on the same network as Supergirl. My DC cinematic.
Didn't Supergirl change providers? Or whatever.
I'm unsure. That's why I'm throwing this out there, because it also just came to Netflix a couple of days ago. The first season of Supergirl is now available on Netflix. So I might
have to check that out.
Yeah, I was going to check it out, too. Actually, you know what? I think that was on CBS. Whoever's listening to this probably knows that we're completely stupid about this, but
I thought they just changed it, so.
Let us know. Anyone listening who can set us straight on this, let us know.
Yes, it was on CBS, and I believe now it's on the CW.
Oh, okay. The Flash is definitely on CW.
Yeah.
All right, did we cover everybody? I think we did, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. Jay, what is the community question for next week?
The community question for next week is, what game do you consider to have the best story? This is of all time, or at least of your all time. So curious, what game you played do you believe has the best story?
Now, some games might have the shittiest mechanics, might not be a great game, but has a great story. So it doesn't necessarily have to be the best game of all time, just a game that had the best story.
Yeah. Yeah, this is going to be a tough one for me. Like,
because usually they go hand in hand. There's very few times that you're like, wow, that had great story, but I guess there's a few out there that I could think of that had great story but crappy gameplay. But anyway, yeah, we'll save it for next week. There are some that come right to mind that I can think of, but usually the best stories, the best, we're talking like, you know, the top three, also have really, really good gameplay, too.
Should we do top three? Should we do top three or just top one?
If people want to do their top three, they can throw them in there. Otherwise, then we'll just stick in with the story here is with the original question. What game do you consider to have the best story?
Ever.
Ever!
So last week, we asked people what they thought about the early access games and when they should have paid DLC. Cord, do you want to weigh in on that before we read the listener feedback we got about this?
Yeah, I heard you guys talk about Ark. I like the game is, when you compare it to other games that are technically still in early access, it is leagues beyond those games. I mean, they could really, you know, slap a done sticker on this and say it's done. We're going to continue to support it with updates. I'm not sure why they don't. They have a few small things to do here and there. They seem to have, like, I don't know what you want to call it, ADD, as far as a studio goes. They get ideas about other projects they can do, like Survival of the Fittest or Scorched Earth, and they just, I mean, they're not a big studio. So when, you know, they want to pursue a project, it takes a lot of their manpower, and they have to pursue it. So I get the irritation that they haven't technically finished their game yet. But as far as charging for Scorched Earth goes, if you're an ARK player and you've picked it up and you checked it out, I understand why you would pay more for it, because it's practically a completely another game. Like, when you say it's a new map, it's not like a Call of Duty map. It's like the size of you know, the modern Grand Theft Autos. It's like one of those, a completely new world. Like, imagine if they were just like, here's Liberty City now.
It was a sort of along the lines of what I said last week. You know, Scorched Earth just wasn't thrown together. It took a lot of work, a lot of man hours, a lot of sacrifice. They felt it justified the cost.
Yeah, and the game, you know, if you bought it, the game constantly goes on sale. And originally, if you bought it, you know, I believe the price is still $30. So if you buy the original and then buy Scorched Earth, that's $50. That's the price of a game. You know, so I think it's a lot of entitled gamers out there complaining that who don't really understand how the economy works. Like, all these people in the studio, they need to eat. They need to get paid. It's not cheap to make a game, you know?
So let's get some feedback from Denny here, who always comes to us with very thoughtful and insightful feedback. So we appreciate that. And he has a different spin. So he says, thanks, Gamers in Beta, for your professional and objective coverage of the PS4 Pro, the best I have heard, and I really enjoyed all the input. Kudos to everybody. My thoughts on free DLC for early access was thinking as appreciation for helping them iron out the game and providing income to them before they even have a full-featured functional game. So yes, it could be a real-world option. And you're very right. Developers could say, you know what, you gave us your $30 as an act of faith, and as a reward for that, everything we release to you early access people is going to be free. I still think there comes a time where you have to say, all right, it's been a year, or it's been a year and a half. We've given you a lot of stuff free. From here on, you got to start paying. I don't think that's unrealistic, but Denny, I can see both sides to that. I really can.
It's also it's been a fully functional game for a while. I believe the original is still $30 and constantly goes on sale for, you know, downwards toward like $10, I think. And they've released so many updates that aren't just like, you know, ironing out bugs. They're like, here's the center, which is another whole map. That one was completely free, by the way. And here's all these new animals, all these new game mechanics. Like, the game is constantly refreshing and almost a new game all the time. And I can't think of a game that people are still this into after a year. There's still such a huge, vibrant community behind it, even though it's still in early access, technically.
You wonder why they just wouldn't delay that Scorched Earth for a month or two. Maybe they needed the money, like Sean said last week. But it just seemed like, why take the bad PR hit? Finish up. Because it seems like ARK is almost done, right? Isn't it going to come out soon?
It was supposed to finish up, and then it's not coming to PS4 until it's technically, legally, completely finished. And I think that was supposed to happen, like, this summer. So I don't know if – I mean, they go beyond their – they miss their launch dates all the time.
It got delayed for Scorched Earth.
Yeah.
Let's just say it's coming to PS4 November 1st. You think they might have delayed the DLC just for a little bit to avoid any PR hit. But again, they might have needed that money. They might have, you know, bills to pay, like Corey says. And if any of that legality stuff that Sean mentioned last week is true, then they certainly need money as well. So there's a lot of behind-the-scenes stuff that we don't know. I want to shift real quick, but still talk about ARK on the PS4. Last week, Corey, we discussed mods and them not coming to the PS4. So that means if your ARK is going to come to the PS4, it's just always going to be in its vanilla state, updated, you know, with the usual updates of the game, but no one can really do anything to it. How do you feel about that?
Yeah, you and I talked about the whole mods thing, because that news came out, what was it, like the morning of the Boston Festival of Indie Games, right? That Sony was not going to allow mods. Some games really lend themselves to mods, like all the Bethesda game and Ark especially. So I think it's a really big misstep for Sony to not – I think they haven't figured out how to monetize them yet or how to police them. And I think they're just as, you know, as a stuffy – older Japanese company who doesn't want to be told this is the new landscape, I think they're just like, no, we're not going to do it, which I think is a misstep. You know, the last time a stuffy old Japanese company didn't want to admit that the internet was the future, you know, Nintendo got left in the dust. So I think they should get with it. I think mods are an important part of the gaming industry, and I think they should come to consoles. And if the Xbone is going to allow mods and the PS4 will not, Microsoft's going to exploit the shit out of that.
Right. Mm-hmm. And we were having a spirited conversation on Twitter with Mr. Skyzone and myself going back and forth there. And throughout, you know, later in the week, I was thinking of other things that could be in play here. And I don't want to beat this up too much. But is there any situation or scenario that you guys can think of where Sony just can't figure this out from a technical standpoint and they're hiding behind policy and bureaucracy, that maybe they just can't get this to work on their end?
I don't know enough about the specs, like the technical side, to be able to tell you that, but I can't imagine. They're a, you know, multi-billion dollar company.
Yeah, I mean, I guess not even
company.
Mods so much, but a lot of the things they're not willing to do, not willing to change your screen name, not willing to do cross-play with Xbox, is a lot of it. It's getting to the point now where it's building. It's not just one thing here, one thing there. It's a lot of things, right? So now it's bubbling over. And I'm getting to the point where, all right, is it just someone who's – are they just hard-headed? Do they want the money? Or can they just not fucking figure it out? You know, I feel like it's in one of those three buckets, and maybe we'll never know. But
maybe they should have hired E instead of Pokemon.
You have a lot of faith in that E guy. He was without a job for a long time, Jay.
Yeah, he was. I'm just saying.
All right. Let's move into what we've been playing, because the list looks longer than usual. Who would like to go first? Is anybody dying to talk about what they've been playing?
I can get it out of the way quickly.
All right, Jay.
I dove back into Destiny. Boy, was that a mistake.
Yeah,
I got about 10 hours sleep this weekend.
Oh, I thought you meant because it sucks.
Believe it or not, Joe, it is a very good game. It's just the grind gets...
Yeah, how many times did you play the same mission over and over again?
Actually, I got into some new missions because I've been out of it for quite a while. So,
how close are you to 301? Are you already there?
Yeah, I'm already there.
How many of those new missions were on the same exact map as all the other ones?
Just from a different angle. They put five guys over in the corner, except instead of three.
It's still fun to play. I don't care if I'm going over the same maps and stuff. And believe me, I'm one to shit all over it if that was the case. But I do miss playing it occasionally because the shooting mechanics are so good, and then there is, you know, it does get in depth. The raids are a lot of fun, and then just playing with other people, and you know, I mean, it's been a while since I think all of us have played any co-op or multiplayer with others that much, you know, in the past few months here. So
don't you know us by now, Jay? We don't play well with others.
Well,
don't you know that by now?
We got time, to play video games. We got.
Were you watching Twitter?
We got podcast.
Yeah. So this has done that along with some, you know, Sniper Elite for me. So I've gone back in and played that. I still don't know if I'm going to get Rise of Iron. Boing. And
come on, you can't boing yourself.
I had to.
It's like giving yourself a reach around.
Yeah. Pat on the back when I'm done.
Big penis.
So I'm playing that and enjoying that. I don't know. The grind has been reduced a little bit. Now you can buy. My biggest issue with Destiny was having to run around the damn map and just, I mean, you weren't really doing much other than running around trying to find Spirit Bloom, Relic Iron, and Helium Vials or whatever they call it. That just irritated the hell out of me. It was boring. You weren't really doing anything. It was just a major fetch quest that was very intensive. You just basically had to run laps around a map. That was irritating.
You don't want to go pick flowers for an hour in a shooter?
Yeah, basically. So that's what irritated me the most. But now you can buy that stuff. So, and you use the glimmer that you gain. I believe it's the glimmer that you gain from shooting stuff. So you can run around and shoot and do that now. So that's
glimmer and Wolf Among Us, or was that glamour?
That was glamour. Yeah. I've been playing Witcher 3 Blood and Wine, of course, again, so I won't beat that one up, but I finally gave up. I was chasing the Wolven gear, and I gave up on that and went back into the story, and that's kind of what made me think of the question of for next week. Man, that story is so good. It just it draws me in and makes me want to play more, and then also the story that was in Soul Suspect was good too, even though the gameplay was meh. That's what kept me going in that one too. But now the Blood and Wine, I really want to get that finished up, and I'm trying to finish games now. I've been playing some Doom also, enjoying that. Not much different from that. Again, fast gameplay and enjoying it. I finally figured out how to pay attention to the map so I know where I am and can actually get around the the area is better now. So, Forza Horizon 3 demo is out on the Xbox One. So fired that up and really enjoying that. The gameplay is fun. Got to kind of get used to it because it is kind of twitchy. I mean, just a little bit of a stick move and you're in the woods. But
now, I played this as well, and I thought it, just like you said, looks absolutely gorgeous. Very easy to pick up and play. Mm-hmm. But did I miss it? Was there a way for us to do co-op so we could try this drop in and drop out? Was that available?
I don't know. We'll have to try it because it's a demo, so it should stay up there for good. So because
I got to the point where everything like opened up on the map.
Mm-hmm.
I could play a bunch of stuff, but I didn't see the option to invite people and stuff like that. Maybe that's in there, but
I don't know. We'll have to check it out. We'll have to report back next week.
Because that's the stuff, it's out this week, and that's the stuff I want to try before I buy it.
Yeah, I agree. Based off of that, and if you can do the drop-in, drop-out, and it works well, would you pick it up?
I think so.
Yeah. Now, Corey, have you tried this?
I have not. I have not played a racing game for quite some time, but it did look really cool. I was not aware the demo was out. I think I'm going to go download that, actually, tonight.
Yeah, it's pretty beautiful.
And Joe, did you watch anybody streaming it?
Are you waiting for that, Jay? Are you waiting for...
I had to ask.
All right, now let's get to the meat of the matter here, Joe.
Yes, and I played the 4 Anna Alpha.
Yeah, baby.
Yeah. I hate this game.
If anybody wants it without an accent, it's a 4 Honor.
if you don't speak Maine.
You guys are so East Coast.
It's faux Anna. What are you talking
Anna
about?
For Anna.
It's not real Anna. It's faux Anna. Yeah.
So what are you guys playing the Alpha on? Steam or Xbox One?
The One.
I am on Xbox One.
Okay.
Yeah, I just... It reminds me of a fighting game. You have to do the right moves, and it's a timing thing. With, you know, playing against other characters. I haven't played against other people because I know I'm just going to get instantly get my ass whooped.
So that's all I've done. All I've done is the 4v4 Dominion.
Maybe I should try that. I don't know.
I've only done with people.
It looks very, very Bushido Blade. Does it feel like Bushido Blade?
That's exactly what I was hoping it was going to be. It depends on what mode you're going in. So they have 3 different modes that are available currently. There's Duel, which is 1v1, and then they have 2v2 and 4v4.
Mm-hmm.
And I've tried all of them, and if you do Bushido Blade, that's the closest... Or I'm sorry, the Duel, 1v1, that's the closest you're going to get to Bushido Blade. But it's not quite where you can like just get that one shot in that's real skillful and kill them.
Okay.
You actually have like a health bar, and you have to chain combos and deflect attacks and a bunch of stuff like that.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because I was wondering if you could just like, if you got an axe right to the chest, that was just game over.
Yeah, man. That was my dream of what this game was going to be.
Axes and chests.
But I got to put it out there. I said I do not like this game. It's because it's not my type of game. I can see the glimmer of hope in it that there is a lot of people that are going to like this game. It's just I'm not very good at the fighting game kind of thing. And I think there's going to be people that maybe aren't into the fighting game thing that will like this. It's just not my kind. But there were some points running around the battlefield and just, you know, wailing on other people. And then there is definitely skill involved in this. And you also have to plan because you have to try to take other areas while the other team's trying to take your areas and stuff. So it gets pretty involved, and I can see this being a selling well. I can see it selling well because it is very interesting. It's not boring. It's just, like I said, for me, I say that I don't like it but that's the gameplay style. It's not my type of gameplay style. So whatever you do, don't have me review this game.
I think it's going to do really well for them. And I think for people out there that aren't great at fighting, there's still a lot of other stuff you can do. So the 4v4, that's like domination in Call of Duty, right? There's three spawn points or, you know, three objectives that you have to go and capture.
Yeah, the three objectives, yeah.
So there's stuff like that you can run around. I can't speak to the other modes, but in 4v4, there's also, like, you know, non-playable characters that you can beat up and get points.
Which are really MOBA-like, you know, they're like the creeps, and you're just going through and mowing them down.
Yeah, you get 1 point each for every time you kill one of them. So there was a lot of stuff like that you can do. And what I did is I went back and just did a tutorial a couple times. You know, you got to hold down the left trigger and then sort of use the directional and which way you want to block, and then you use your, you know, either your strong attack or moderate attack. Once I got the hang of that, I was deflecting stuff no problem and delivering some pretty cool hits. Now, I'm not great at the executions or anything like that yet, but...
Yeah, there's some time into those.
I'm still having a blast.
Yeah. So I would liken it to a cross between Bushido Blade, Dark Souls, and then kind of like... Oh no, suddenly I just lost that third game, but Dynasty Warriors.
Mm. Yeah, that's what it reminded me of, is Dynasty Warriors. Some look, but it looks pretty gorgeous too.
The graphics are incredible. Then, yeah,
that intro movie is cool.
No. Yeah, but even the gameplay itself, I mean, in game it looks good.
Mm.
You know, you can see
PC
pretty good
too.
Oh, I haven't played it on PC.
Joe's playing it on PC. I played some of it on PC, and PC looks phenomenal. And I still thought the drop down when you go to Xbox One still looked very good.
Are you playing on your 1070 now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
It must look damn good then.
Yes.
Yeah, I thought it was really good. I've only played against people. I didn't bother. You know, I figured might as well just do a trial by fire. I'm not going to mess around with bots. So I hopped in. I started off with just duels so I can get a little bit more of a hang of the 1v1 stuff. And then after I was doing pretty good at that, I moved up to the 2v2. And once I got a little more comfortable with that, I got into 4v4. And that's totally unlike the other two modes. The other two modes are just like pure combat. And then the 4v4 has more like objectives and killing the creeps and capturing points and all that kind of stuff. So... it's pretty good.
I'll have to try that one.
All right. Anything else, Jay?
I've got to say that, does this seem like an alpha to any of you?
No.
It is an alpha. Oh.
No, does it seem like an alpha? I mean, does it play like an alpha? This seems like a polished game.
They got their shit together on this one.
Yeah, they do.
And I think there's a beta coming, too.
Yeah.
So, and between now and February, I think it comes out middle of February. I want to say the 17th or 18th.
Yeah.
So this should be a fine polished turd by the time it comes out. It should be, should be a very good game.
Yeah,
is
I
the
think
beta open?
I think that the only thing that I've seen... Oh, sorry. The only thing that I've seen that's not like super polished is there's some weird clipping stuff occasionally where you'll just see like the feet.
I did like, have one there. I couldn't see by a rock. All I had was the edge of the rock, and then you could see my feet and like my shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
But that was like only once. So
some of the terrain will be like up to your shin, even though you're supposed to be walking on it. So I don't know. It's just little shit like that.
I wish I could talk about some of the games I've tested over the last week. There's another game that the studio is putting out, and my God, the night and day comparison of where the development is night and day difference.
I guess if you go to the Ubisoft page, you can sign up for the beta when it arrives in beta. So it's not totally open, but I guess you can sign up and hopefully get selected.
Yeah. And running around the battlefield is pretty cool, too, because, I mean, you've got ladders, you've got, this kind of ramparts and stuff like that that you can run down, the kind of like ramps and stuff that come down.
And you run right up to the ladders. You don't press any button. You just run to it and you go up it.
Yeah, and the same thing with coming down. You just run down. You hit the button and you run down. I mean, you climb down quickly and then run across. It's very smooth and it looks incredible.
So devious Mr. Matt won't get stuck on any of these ladders then, is that what you're saying?
No, hopefully. No.
Well, hopefully not. He might. Sorry, Matt. All right, Jay, let's move
that
on.
That pretty much covers what I've played, so.
All right. I'll go next because a lot of what he just mentioned is on my list as well, so I'll be short. ReCore. This is what I was hinting at the top of the show. ReCore is a PS2 game. It is very much like a Ratchet and Clank game, and that's not a bad thing. I like the game. I think it plays well. It's kind of vanilla in some areas. It kind of doesn't look great in some areas, but that's okay. It's still a good game. It's a reason it's priced at $39.99, though, because it's from an era where games were a little bit simpler, and so I think it's at a right price point. Loading screens can be frustrating, especially when they just serve you up a blank black screen with a little, like, white sphere at the bottom center of the page, and you stare at that for 2 minutes. It's a little weird.
Whoa. That is PS2, huh?
But overall, it's very much feels like a Ratchet and Clank game, but just in a different skin. You're this person that has a gun and can shoot things, and you got a little sidekick next to you. Instead of a robot, it's a robot dog. The one thing I don't like is that a lot of the enemies, say about 99% of the enemies that you encounter, there's this extract option where you shoot them and you extract the core from their stomach. And that to me just feels like it's overdone, that it should maybe just be left for some of the higher level enemies and bosses. And right now, with the exception of a few of these robotic flies that fly around, everybody else has the same mechanic in order to kill them. Otherwise, you're shooting them and stunning them for a long time, when you can just shoot them and stun them for a little bit and then pull out their stomach. So that gets a little old after a while.
You mean the fishing part?
Right. Who made that analogy? Was that Sean?
I don't know, but it's a perfect analogy from what I've seen in the videos. So.
Well, it's like tug of war. Basically, yeah. if your line that you're using to extract their core gets too red, you're not going to be able to pull it out. So you have to tug on it. When it turns red, let a little bit of line out, like a fishing rod. when you tug on it and it gets red, just let a little bit off.
Big penis.
This is ripe for sound bites right now.
Yes, I know. But anyways, I tried out the Play Anywhere feature, and that worked with no problems. So I started out on the Xbox One, played maybe about 45 minutes, saved my game, went right into my office, started it up, and it does a couple pop-ups pop up on the screen, asking me to type in my Xbox Live information, verify it. It does that, and then it does a little syncing menu, and then it brought me to the title screen of ReCore and said continue play, and once I continued, I was right where I left off on the Xbox. So no issues there. I was happy that I paid, what I paid for it, a little bit less than $40. I had some PayPal bucks in my inventory, courtesy of Bago Games, so I was able to pay a little cheaper than what I normally do. So
you bought on digital on the One, correct?
I bought it digitally on PC on my computer.
Now, did you get the other game for free? What was it?
No, I don't think I pre-ordered. I think I bought it after it was out.
Oh, you bought it after it was out. Okay.
Yeah. And moving on from that, I'm playing more of Mother Russia Bleeds. And this time around, I am using bots to play along with me. and that just amps up the craziness by like four, or maybe by three, I should say. And so it's just a lot of stuff going on the screen as Dad's Getting Grounded would say. It was very frenetic. And so I'm not sure if I'm going to keep that or not, because it was hard to tell who was the enemies and who was my guys and where these punches and kicks were coming from. It certainly made it felt like it was a little easier because I had some help, even though they do serve up more enemies. So we'll see how that goes. But I am still enjoying that game a lot. And what else am I playing? Woven on the this. They're in Kickstarter right now. This is like a kid's point-and-click game. The whole world is made out of wool and stuffed animals. And it's not really for me, but it looks beautiful, plays okay. You know, maybe when it comes out, I'll give it a fair shake. But for right now, it's just like a tiny demo to whet your appetite so you'll invest in the game on Kickstarter. But if you got some kids around and you got a PC, you know, that they can, you know, sit in your lap, or they're just old enough to sit in front of a computer themselves and use a mouse, it's very easy to use, and they might have some fun with it, but really not for me.
A lot of yarn games this generation. That's like the, you know, the claymation they had back in the Super Nintendo days. Yarn is the modern claymation, I think, with the Yoshi's Woolly World. And what was the other one? What was the one on PS4? Jay, you played that.
Little Big Planet is, you know, has a lot of that stuff in it, too.
True, true.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's me. Corey, you want to go next?
Sure. I'll keep mine short and sweet. I've been playing Ark again. I won't bother you guys about that again. I've also still been playing
Pokemon,
but they really, really need to get on the updates. I mean, the most recent update lets you take a Pokemon and he's like, what is it, Joe? Like your buddy? Is that what they call it? So you can, if you make him your buddy and you walk around with him and you accumulate a certain amount of kilometers, you can earn candy for that particular Pokemon. But I mean, a lot of people are not playing this anymore, so they need to really get into gear with the updates. They need to add trading and so forth soon. The other things I've been playing are Worms WMD. I don't know if there's any other Worms fans. I don't think there's any other Worms cool. fans on this show. But any listeners, if you're into Worms WMD, let me know. I will play with you on Xbox One, because there's not very many of us Worms fans, at least not here in America, I don't think. And last but not least, Don't Starve Together finally came to the PS4. Which is the Don't Starve is the game that got me into survival games. So Don't Starve Together is, came out on PC quite a while ago, like a year or so ago. And it's just multiplayer version of Don't Starve. So me and a couple friends of mine have been playing that lately. And I also just recently started an official Bagel Games server for Don't Starve, which, every time I just got it started, so I haven't tweeted out. But next time I go on and play, I will be tweeting out. That will be on. So up to six people can play at once. So if anybody's interested in playing Don't Starve Together in the game or the Bagel Games community, let me know. So that's pretty much what I've been playing.
Cool. Joe?
All right. Well, I got a chance to play Conga Master on the PC. I got a code to review it. And so I got it on Steam and fired it up. And it's pretty funny. Like, there's no real dialogue and there's not much of a story. You're basically just trying to be like the talk of the town, like the king of the dance. And basically you be the master of the conga. And basically the only dialogue in the game is when you first start a level, you kick open the doors and you go, "What could possibly go wrong?" And then you start dancing it up. And basically there's just like random people all throughout the level. And you have to, like, circle them and get their interest up to join your conga line. And then they'll join your conga line. And the more people you have, the easier it is to get other people. So you just try and go through until you have enough people. And then you leave the room. And you can accumulate huge combinations. And you can only turn in clockwise or counterclockwise circles. And it gets pretty difficult. They add little things that can trip you up in there, and it's an entertaining game. I put up a review on gamersinbeta.com if you want to read up on it and see some screenshots. And it's pretty cheap. It's only like $9.99, So it's a fun game to kill, you know, 10, 20 minutes with. And then...
Is it like Snake with humans? Is that kind of what you have to do? Like build your line of people just to dance?
You can... I thought that you wouldn't be able to touch the people in your conga line, but you can just walk through them. So the snake analogy, unfortunately, falls short on this one.
What are the levels like? Are they like bar mitzvahs and weddings and stuff?
So you start off in like a disco hall, and then you go to say like a bar, and then you go to like the food court in the mall, and then you can go to like a you end up in the under the sea themed school dance from Back to the Future.
Oh, Enchantment Under the Sea.
And you can get Marty and the DeLoreans parked out front. So. Pretty sweet.
I'm into it. Although the DeLorean was never parked out front during that dance. Just to push up my nerd glasses there for a second.
Fan service, really. And then I played a little more Pokemon Omega Ruby. I'm not going to get into it very much, but I beat the Elite Four and then found out, wait a second. Cool, they added new content. So it's not just fully a remaster of the old game from Game Boy Advance. They added what's called the Delta episode, which adds like a weird, like a big giant meteorite's coming to crash onto the Earth. And you are supposed to take care of it. But the energy that the Devon Corp has been using is going to destroy a alternate universe. I don't know. It's pretty weird. And it's kind of cool. It's more content and I dig it. So it was totally unexpected. I had no idea they added that in.
Pokemon.
And then did a little bit of that For Honor game that we talked about earlier. So I got that out of my system already. And then the grand finale here, played some Harambe versus Capcom.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
I want some explanation for what the fuck that is.
So basically some dude is basically illegally distributing a ROM hack. Of I think it's one of the Street Fighter Alpha games, and he added a gorilla into it with his own moveset, and your first enemy is a zookeeper, and then the rest of the enemies are just Street Fighter characters.
Is it well balanced? Like, just throwing a new character in a Street Fighter game is a big endeavor. Like, is it more of a joke thing, or is it actually kind of balanced?
I mean, it's pretty much just a joke. I was able to hold my own, you know. It's pretty fast-paced, and I was able to hold my own using his moves and everything. I didn't really get stumped by anything up until you get to the final guy, which is Evil Ken, which is also a ROM-hacked character. And they have him on, like, expert difficulty, and I can't beat him.
Does he have a gun? He should have a gun if he's the last guy.
He does not have a gun, but he should. But yes, I thought that was hilarious. And, you know, so I've been able to live out and fulfill my fantasy of being a gorilla that has, you know, become a martyr for all of us.
A fantasy we all share, I think.
Cool. Anything else to add, Joe?
No, that's it.
You want to leave it on that note?
Yeah.
I need monkey sound effects on the soundboard. That's all I got.
All right. Well, we're going to try something new here. I've come up with the game, and the name of the game is called Games That Start With the Letter. And the letter this week is the letter H. Okay?
Holy shit.
Give me something for that, Corey.
I didn't even realize that was a joke.
Ooh. What? All right. And the other hint I will give you two hints. Halo is not one of the games.
Yes.
And these are all modern games. And what I mean by that is from the original Xbox up through right now.
So like 2000 on then or so.
Right. There's nothing retro here or anything like that.
How does a game work exactly? What's going to happen?
Well, basically, I don't want people just blurting out the answer, because my logic behind this is, let me read the description, Because so hopefully maybe you guys have played these and we can talk about it a little bit. And then people listening at home, maybe they haven't played these games before. And by reading the description, it'll maybe entice them to go out and play it themselves. So let me get through the description. If someone says they know it, you know, certainly when I'm done, you know, then you can jump in and say you know it or something like that.
So, yeah, should we ring in or should we just blurt out the answer after you're done reading it?
Yeah, we could try blurting it out once I'm done reading it.
Okay. I'm going to blur it all over the place.
All right. So this first one, and by the way, I should say that these, what I'm reading are, could either be ESRB ratings, someone's review, or some sort of marketing that the developer or publisher put out themselves.
Okay.
So a fresh take on the classic fantasy game that delivers the intensity and action of a modern-day shooter. Taking control of either Ilara, a ranged weapon expert, or Kadok, a master swordsman, you and your partner will descend into a dark and foreboding world for an unforgettable cooperative experience. Anybody have an answer on that?
I am blank, and I wish those names rang bells with me. They don't.
Same. I don't know.
I'll give you a hint. Bethesda. PAX East. Bethesda.
PAX East Bethesda game.
Hearthstone.
Oh.
Fuck it. I had something out there. Starts with an H.
So if you remember this from 4 or 5 years ago at PAX East, I'm assuming nobody knows it, right?
No, I don't.
Hunted, the Demon's Forge.
Oh shit! I liked that game too.
You remember that they had at PAX East? They had the big statues and everything.
Mm-hmm.
I do. I never played it though. I never would have guessed that. I didn't realize that was Bethesda. That,
that threw me off.
All right, next. Plays like a self-contained open-world game, and every target or objective can be handled in many different ways. Shooting someone with your silenced pistol certainly works, but so does rigging their car with explosives or arranging for something heavy to accidentally fall on them. The game is full of options, and exploring the different ways to take out a target is as much fun as the deed itself.
Hitman!
Which one?
Go.
It's not go.
Bloodlines?
I should just give you Hitman, but it's... Joe, do you have a guess beyond Hitman?
I'm looking at my Steam library for the one I have.
You guys are all looking at...
Damn it,
cheater.
See, Hitman. I like this game because it's timing, too.
Hitman Absolution.
Oh.
I'll give you Corey. I'll give you Hitman.
Wasn't Hitman Go? You sure it wasn't Hitman Go?
It was not Hitman Go.
I just got Hitman Go and Lara Croft Go for 99¢.
That's why I said it, because I saw you just tweet that the other day, and that was the Hitman that was in my head.
All right. Years ago, during the Cold War, the U.S. military made a new superhuman formula called Formula X, but the project for its use failed. The bunker for the experiments was shut down and abandoned. In 1991, 7 years before the Kurian Mansion incident, AMS Special Agent G is given his first assignment and sent to a small town in Louisiana to investigate a series of disappearances and hunt down a deranged crime boss, Papa Caesar.
House of the Dead?
Can you give me a little bit more than that, Joe?
Fuck. No.
House of the Dead? Fuck no.
I never heard of that one. I gotta try that.
Joe was right. House of the Dead Overkill.
Overkill, yes, that's the other word I couldn't remember.
So Joe and Corey here 1-1. Alright, 2 left, guys. This is an action adventure game in which players assume the role of a plane crash survivor on islands overrun with zombies. As players learn survival skills and interact with other characters, they can assemble tools and weapons to kill hordes of attacking zombies.
How to Survive.
Yes.
I was like, Dead Island doesn't start with an H.
Yeah,
I love that game too. I played the shit out of that.
All right, this is how suspenseful this is.
This is a good game.
Last question. You're all tied up. Yeah. All right. This one here, you got to be fast.
You can't. I'm tied up.
Okay. Rely on your wits to choreograph your way through seemingly impossible situations as you constantly find yourself outnumbered by vicious enemies. The action is unrelenting and every shot is deadly, so each move must be quick and decisive if you hope to survive and unveil the sinister forces driving the bloodshed.
How the fuck am I supposed to get it with that description?
Well, yeah, I'm thinking bloodshed is like, is that the name of something in the game?
Come on, guys. This is easy. This is low-hanging fruit.
It sounds like just like a vague description for a brutal game.
Everybody ready? Everybody got their hand on the buzzer?
All right. Reread it.
Both hands.
I'm going to give you a hint. We already discussed it tonight.
Honor 4.
No. I'll give you one other hint. And that's going to – the buzzers are going to go off. The buzzers are going to go off like crazy. You ready? Is everybody ready?
I'm ready.
Ape Out.
Harambe? Ape Out. Ape Out's the game. Ape Out? Is that the game? Ape Out?
Come on, guys. Hotline Miami.
Oh, Hotline Miami. Fuck. We all get – yes, that was easy. Fuck.
All right, three-way tie. We'll see if I bring the game back. Does everybody like that? Is that cool? Decent? Okay.
Yeah, I mean,
except
was close.
For the three-way tie, I want to fucking win.
Well, better luck next time.
Son of a bitch.
So that game was brought to you by the letter H.
By the letter H, thank you. And let's move on to the notable releases for the week. We talked last week, we're going to start doing some of these again, but just the big ticket items here. So the third piece of paid DLC for Star Wars Battlefront's coming out. It's called Battle Station. It looks like the next one for Rogue One is coming out sometime in December. Destiny, we already talked about. Rise of Iron is out this week, as well as Batman Telltale Games' second episode. This one's called The Children of Arkham. Firewatch is coming to the Xbox One.
Which you should play if it hasn't been spoiled for you yet. I highly recommend it.
Severed, which was probably one of the best PS Vita games to come out. That's coming to the Wii U. And we've already talked about Forza Horizon 3.
Yeah.
So some of those are the big ticket items this week. Let's move on to a little bit of news and then we'll be all done. All of Battlefield 4's major expansions are now free on Xbox One, PS4, and PC. So if Battlefield 1 got you in the mood for some Battlefield and you haven't picked up any of the DLC, now you can go ahead and download them.
Anybody on here
nice.
Done it?
I have not. Have you?
I downloaded it on one.
Cool. I'll have to do so.
Because I have...
I think I have one day to do it. It's offers only good for 1 week starting on the 13th. So you have about... excuse me. Beer is stuck in my throat. 2-3 weeks left. 2 to 3 days left.
Yeah, you got to get this episode up quick.
That's right. That's what she said. Get it up quick.
Yeah.
that I just didn't want to play the boner sound again.
A little worked out.
Yeah. It's red now. We've been yanking on it.
Jesus. Pleasure blisters. So one of the complaints we already talked about with the PlayStation Network is that you cannot change your username. On Battle.net, like most places, you are entitled to one free change. Don't like your name Dick Hugger? Change it to something else.
Stop hugging dicks.
And so now it's a $10 fee. What was that?
That's kind of a funny one. Why would you want to change it from Dick Hugger?
It is a pretty good one. Yeah. We want
sure
credit. If you name yourself Dick Hugger, we want credit.
There's got to be a bio section. So if you name yourself Dick Hugger, please put in your bio a link to gamersandbeta.com.
You gotta plug us because you're gonna be famous with that.
Oh, I don't want to be plugged.
Oh, plug us.
Oh wow, this go downhill.
There you go.
So yes, the second time you make the change, it is a $10 fee. Which I think Xbox does as well right now.
Yes.
You can do one for free, second time's on you. PlayStation, get your act together.
Oh, PlayStation, it costs you, what, 60?
Can't do anything. Yeah, you have to create a whole new one.
Exactly.
And fuck any trophies that you have.
Yep.
That's why I haven't done it yet. This next item here, Valve removes Digital Homicide's games from Steam. Jay, can you tell us what's going on with this?
Digital Homicide has a bunch of games on Steam. And from what I have seen here, they have filed a bunch of lawsuits against users or people that have purchased the game and given bad reviews. And they're suing for $15 million.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
in response to a YouTube video of blasting one of the games for Jim. This was Jim Sterling. They're suing him for $15 million for blasting one of their games on YouTube. Which,
no.
How the hell are they going to win this? This is ridiculous. So
they're suing for $18 million overall for 100 anonymous Steam users. $15 million of that going towards Jim Sterling. They since then have released a statement in response to Valve's decision, illustrating some of the offensive comments they've received in the past from certain Steam users. So they must feel like they're being targeted by a group of people, that it's just not like an arbitrarily, like, this game sucks, that they feel like someone's trolling them or coming back over and over again saying stuff about their games.
Are they aware of how much money the average game journalist makes? $15 million? Yeah,
do you think that Valve commit digital homicide on them?
Oh,
I think they committed homicide on themselves.
Either way, their games have now been removed from Steam. So if you have them, I don't even know if you can play them. Wonder how that works. If they're just being removed from the store or if they're actually removed from your library too. Oh, wait a second. It says here, if you've already bought them or you purchased Steam keys from elsewhere, you can still install and play the game. You just can't buy them.
Yeah, and you better not say anything bad about them either.
They're coming after you. PlayStation 4 got an update this week with update 4.00.
I need to turn mine on.
I have this installed, and I'm taking advantage of some of the features already, specifically folders. I have all my games in the folders now, which is very nice.
Yeah, I did that too. I was looking forward to that for a long time, to be able to put them in folders. Now I did it, and I'm like, I kind of like the way it was arranged before. Like, the most recent thing you used was always at the top. So, but as soon as I made a folder, my OCD kicked in, and I had to alphabetize the whole goddamn thing.
Yeah, I really like the folders. I don't like all the scrolling. They're right there. And especially on some of these other PS4s I have in my house that don't have the big hard drive. So that gets filled up real quick. So the folders just has, 8 to 15 games in there? Not a big deal. Boom. Love it.
Now, is it for each individual one, or does it go across on your account?
Oh, is it individual to the PS4?
To the console?
Oh, I don't know. We only have one username on the PS4. I don't have any sub-accounts.
That's what I mean. If you create a folder on your PS4 and put the games in there, if you go sign in on another PS4, does it show up on there, or is it only on the console?
Yeah, does it rearrange it on all the other consoles too, or no?
That's a good question. I haven't tried that. I have not.
Yeah, not sure if it's specific to console or specific to gamertag or whatever they call the PlayStation. Yeah.
I want to say that it is specific to the console. Because I think I did turn this PS4 on earlier in my office, and it was not in folders, but not 100% sure on that, but I'm pretty sure. So that was one of the most welcome features. People were looking for a way to manage games and apps. So it's not just for games, all your apps and stuff like there. You know, I saw some people on Twitter created a folder that called Bullshit Apps, and they put all their apps that they never use in there.
That's brilliant.
Yeah, who was it? Somebody in the Gamers in Beta community created a shame pile as a folder, games they have not got to yet.
That's right. Brilliant.
That's a good idea, yeah.
Yeah, it is. All my games would be in it.
There's a way to now just press the PlayStation button, and a sort of like snap menu comes up like the Xbox, and you don't have to leave the game to like change a song selection and music and things like that. And there's some other content that pops up in that little menu for things that you can do on the fly now, rather than having to close the game out and go do another task.
I wish I wish they would change the power off, so you could just go to the power off menu and power down your PlayStation was the first option highlighted, because I can't tell you how many times I've accidentally put it into sleep mode when I wanted it off, so then I had to turn it back on and then turn it back off, like completely off. I wish they'd change that, but I guess you can now find out hidden trophies. You can see what hidden trophies are and how to get them. That's a new feature too.
Yep. Other features, obviously all of them now have HDR support. There's a new data transfer feature that lets you move your game saves and account info from one PS4 to another over a wired LAN connection. So if you're, I guess, I'm not sure how that really works. Like, where's the need for that?
Yeah, how many people are doing that?
I don't know. I mean, it's like, I guess if you're going to trade it in, but wouldn't you have already traded it in before you bought it?
Yeah, typically they're not going to let you, like, yeah, let me unbox this in GameStop and transfer right. all my shit. Then he can take it away.
Yeah,
so well, that would work for you, Mike, because you have multiples in the house. You could just transfer it over to one of the other ones, and then when you get back, transfer it onto the new one.
It seems like a pain in the ass to reach in the entertainment units, to unplug them all, bring one into the other room.
Well, can't you do it wirelessly?
No, it's wired.
Oh, it's wired. Okay.
That'll be the next update.
That'll be the next update.
Lastly, the support also adds support for Twitch, YouTube, and daily motion broadcast in 720p at 60 frames per second. Changes for trophies, as Corey already mentioned, hidden trophies. So I think it looks similar, but there is stuff in there that you got to go look at that is pretty cool, subtle stuff that makes it a little bit more user-friendly, in my opinion. Although I really, always really like the interface anyways. So.
Yeah, me too.
Let's see what else we have here. Last thing, Resident Evil 7 demo, now out on the PS4. This looks like an enhancement or an update to the original Resident Evil 7 demo. You had a chance to scope this out at all, Joe?
No, I haven't, you know, since that PS4 is out.
Oh, that's right, you don't have the PS4, that's right. So an update for the Resident Evil 7's beginning hour demo has been released on the PS4. The Twilight demo, as Capcom is calling it, will allow players to explore more of the mysterious and derelict mansion featured in the original. Now is your chance on your own, if you haven't had the chance to before, as both newcomers and veterans of beginning hour will be able to see what's changed in the rundown rooms and decrepit corridors. Something you're going to scope out, Corey? Did you play the first one?
I downloaded the first one. I don't think I ever actually played it. I should, though. Now that this is out, too, I really should get to that. If I had a shame pile folder, it would be in it.
They've also upped the cost on the deluxe edition from $79.99 to $89.99.
You bastards.
Because they've...
Pre-order canceled.
There's going to be a third story expansion. That's going to cost you an extra $10. January 24th, that's coming out, so not too far away. And it's going to have HDR support on both the PlayStation 4 Pro and the Xbox One S. And that's all the news I had for this week, guys. It's been a relatively slow week compared to last week with all the console news. Now, Corey, I know you weren't on last week, and before we started, you said you didn't have much to offer on the PS4 Pro, but quickly give us an opinion, something on it.
It's oddly targeted. Like, I don't know what the audience is for that. It's like people with 4K TVs who don't own a PS4 yet but have been debating it. It seems like a very small audience. That and the update junkies, which there are a few on this show, let's be honest.
Yes, sir. Now, what about the person that is not an Xbox gamer and not a PC gamer? They're just a Sony guy. They love the PlayStation brand. And they want the latest and greatest. They're going to trade in the PS4, and they're going to get the PS4 Pro. That doesn't make sense?
They already have a PS4. I don't understand why. I mean, their PS4 probably has, what, the same size hard drive, if not bigger, already. So, I mean, I don't think you're getting that much for updating your PS4. But, you know, like I said, update junkies or diehard Sony fans will probably do it, but it seems odd.
Or you know, people getting PSVR so that you get the better performance out of it.
That's the thing. I'm curious as to how VR performs on the Pro versus the day one version. Like,
I bet there's going to be a difference.
If it's a drastic difference, then I'm going to take it into consideration because I know I'm going to buy PSVR eventually. I can't afford to be an early adopter of it, at least not, you know, within the next couple of months. But if it's drastic, if it only really works on the Pro and, you know, it just stutters like a bastard on the original, then maybe I guess it makes more sense.
So you're not a 4.2 flops guy. That's not enough to entice you. You're hanging tough with the 1.8 flops.
Yeah, my 1.8 flops, it's floppy enough for me.
All right. Let's see. Well, we certainly missed Sean this week. We hope everything is okay on his end. He had a bail at the last minute, so we look forward to having him back on when he can. Trying to think if there's any plugs this week. We're threatening people out there to record a new episode of the 40cast next Saturday, so be on the lookout for that. Certainly head on over to gamersinbeta.com. Joe did two reviews this week, one for the Final Station, the other for Conga Master. I put a review up there for the HyperX Cloud Revolver headset. I'm working on a review for the Cloud X, so continue going to the website. And beyond that, go check out the other podcast out there. I enjoyed Dad's Getting Grounded this week. That was good stuff.
I'll bang on mine real quick. You can follow me on Twitter at Catwood. Follow Bagel Games on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I'm their social media manager, so do it because I told you so. And you can find my further thoughts on the games that we saw at the Boston Fig. I think Intern Astronaut and the other one I didn't mention, Anamorphine. My hands-on previews for those are up. The other three are going up soon. Should be up by the time this episode goes up. If you play Don't Starve, check out the Bagel Games server. If you follow us on one of the social medias, you'll see when I tweet when that server is live. And if you want to check out my opinion on Final Station, you can check out that review at Bagel Games also. I think Joe and I, we had a couple of minor disagreements, I think, about the game. I think you were a little kinder to the game than I was. I meant to bring it up, actually, this episode so we could talk about it, but it's sure. Too late for that. And, yeah, that's it for me.
All right, Jay.
I'm going to plug my co-hosts because they write way more reviews than I do. I'm all verbal, no write. So check out their reviews on Bago Games for Corey and on our site, gamersinbeta.com. And appreciate you guys doing those things and getting the words out there along with Mike with his reviews. So everybody knows that I like the HyperX stuff, but I think I'm going to break down and pick up another set of Cloud 2s just because they're so versatile.
I want to see. I'm curious to see what makes the Cloud X's only Xbox. I want to see what's in the box that makes them only Xbox. Because if it's just a 3.5 millimeter, can I use them anywhere?
Yeah, but I bet it has the volume and stuff like that built in. It must have that somehow. All right. Nope. I don't remember when we were at the booth. I thought it had some kind of little dongle like that or whatever.
All right. Well, that's what I'm going to check out this week.
Anything's got to be better than the Cloud Strife.
I don't even know where to go with it.
Add to that?
If you want to support me, go watch any of the videos on our YouTube channel for our eBay stuff. It's State's Place that pays some of my bills, so any more traffic is always welcome.
Or goes buy your stuff on eBay and hopefully Joe's one of the sellers.
Is there a spotlight item that we can cover this week for you? Something that really sizzles and pops?
No, the wife did a daily vlog every day of this week to try and get our traffic up because we were pretty lazy for the first 2 weeks. And it worked. And it's really entertaining. And I do videos where I talk about the shit I'm shipping out once in a while. So if you want to watch me act like a complete dumbass, those are pretty fun.
Now, do you ever get anybody that says, well, I was going to buy this until I saw your husband wearing this bra, and now I don't want to buy it because he might have stretched it out? Or
it's called a bro. Like, all right. It's called a bro.
No.
A manzier.
Yeah.
No, nobody. Everybody is pretty stoked on us.
Pre-worn Joe State stuff.
Generally, you know.
Pre-worn
everybody,
Joe State.
Everybody generally thinks I'm hilarious. So actually, that's not true, because when Nicole goes on other shows, people go and run their mouth, and they like to just be vocal. Remember a couple of weeks ago, Nicole was on this other show, and this guy just commented, "Nicole, thumbs up. Joe, thumbs down." Like, weren't even talking about me. Nobody mentioned our show at all. Like, it was so fucking hilarious. Like, who the fuck are you, you prick? Who so even asked your opinion?
Like, by the secretly way, fuck trade waiters just for no reason. Right. Out of the blue.
Secretly had a crush on you.
Must be.
All right. Anything else to add, gentlemen?
Nope.
Can't think of anything?
I think we're done here.
All right. Well, that's 169. Next week, we'll be back with 170, 30 closer to 200, gentlemen. So, Jay, do us the honors.
Until next time, same beta time, same beta channel.
Okay. So here I am, there you are. I understand my rationale, my reason to turn, my reason for being, my relationship between God, man, me, you, and your total lack of interest. That's all wrong!
Mine's long. Now what do I do?
Ooh.
if it's longer than 4 hours, don't call a doctor.